Welcome, everyone. I'm Tanya Fitzpatrick.
And I'm Ian Fitzpatrick, and this is World Footprints.
You know, for the last several weeks, really months, we've all been stuck at home. And when you're used to moving, as we are, as travel journalists, you might be feeling like a caged bird whose wings have been clipped. And maybe some of us have been snacking a little bit more, but we're certainly not moving as much as we used to. And I, for one, am getting quite stiff just sitting here in my chair working. And so we wanted to bring somebody on to help all of us get moving again and stay fit and healthy during this mandatory pause.
Neila Bond is a corporate wellness expert and fitness trainer, and she joins us today from the Milwaukee area. Neila, welcome, and how are you doing, and how are things going in your area?
So I'm doing pretty good, and things are going pretty well here. In response to the COVID-19, the county, which was leading our state, is now starting to see a trend down, and then throughout the state, we're actually seeing an uptick in infection rate. So, but our county is doing much better, and I'm happy about that, which means that we've kind of pushed that curve a little bit further than the rest of the state.
Now, how have you adjusted to this new normal in terms of your daily life, your work schedule, and things involving your family as well?
So fortunately, I'm working for a wellness company. We were ahead of the curve, and I started working from home the second week of March. So I have been in the house working from home. Fortunately, my husband was working from home for about 4 weeks, and now he's going in and out. He goes into the office 3 days a week and coming home. I'm teaching my group exercise classes and doing personal training online. So I've adjusted because we need to. And adaptation to change is important for our mental health and our physical well-being.
So for the sake of transparency, Ian and I attend some of your online fitness classes. We're doing some of the yoga, some of the lighter, low impact work, but you're offering many more classes. Talk a little bit about your online courses and your offerings.
So online, I offer a Serenity Bootcamp class, which is what you guys have taken, and our yoga. We offer Serenity Bootcamp twice a week, and it blends Tai Chi sometimes. Sometimes we do Pilates, or we'll use yoga and traditional weight training. And it's designed so that we can stretch, elongate the spine, get deeper breath, but also increase your metabolic outlook and improve your overall well-being. I teach Zumba on Tuesdays and on Saturday morning. And of course, if you're familiar with dance and familiar with Zumba, you know that it's a Latin cardio dance class, and we work really hard and we sweat a lot. And I also do a class called Group Train, and that one is geared to improve your metabolic outlook, but it's heavier weights. It's much more intense. We may have some higher impact in that class. Sometimes it's only 30 minutes, other times it's 45, and then sometimes I do a full hour. Mm-hmm. And that's what I'm currently doing. And I also do some personal training through my virtual studio as well, and nutrition coaching.
So with the virtual training, how has that changed how you go about teaching classes?
It hasn't really changed much, other than I need to log in. I need to be present about 30 minutes before my class starts, where before I was traveling to my class. I travel to the basement and I get logged in and I see who's signed up. And that also prepares me mentally with the group of people that are going to be in front of me, which I've done anyway, but I just did it when they walked in the door. So now I'm doing it a little bit more ahead of time. I do need to let them know what kind of equipment they're going to need. So that's in the description of the class, or if it's a personal training situation, I let them know. And I've been adapting what that equipment may look like for people and giving them other suggestions for heavier weights. Mm-hmm. But it hasn't really changed a whole lot for me.
Now, one of the challenges too with physical training, whether it's one-on-one training, is that having you as a coach and being in a studio versus following you virtually, there are issues that come up in terms of how people are doing certain exercises and techniques that you can't correct when you're doing virtually. So what suggestions would you have for participants to make sure they're feeling okay about what they're doing, even if their positioning and the way that you would coach them has changed?
It depends on who the group is. So if I have a lot of people who are new to working out, I'm not going to offer a class that's just me doing the workout and you following along. I'm going to have it small. I'm going to have everybody on my screen so I can see them. And if I can't see them, I'm going to say, hey, can you position your camera so I can see you moving? Or I'll demonstrate what the exercise is going to look like, and then I watch.
And I know you do a pretty extensive onboarding too.
I do.
Yeah, so you already have an idea of people's capabilities, et cetera.
Exactly. If there's someone new, I'm going to actually communicate with them prior to them taking my classes. I will be instituting a waiver, even though they're in their homes. I'm going to go ahead and add that on starting in June. But I need to know what their health and well-being is so that I can give them guidance, and I'll know, and I will say, hey, you know, so-and-so, this isn't for you. This is what you're going to do, so that they know what to do safely. Mm-hmm. And it's not to call them out, but it's to provide that safe space for them to exercise.
Right. So, for the sake of all of our audiences, you can't get a waiver from all the thousands of people who are watching right now.
Nope.
What are some simple, easy, low impact things that we can do now just to keep mobile and active and a bit healthy?
Well, I know they're hard to find, but some people may have them laying around their house. And if you can see, I'm kind of moving around. And it's because I'm on a stability ball. When you're on that ball, you can move your body and keep the blood flow if you're sitting at your desk, which is where I'm at. And my husband uses a chair, but we have two other stability balls in our little fitness center that he could use if he wanted to. Mm-hmm. Not only that, you need to stretch throughout the day. You need to take time to breathe and stretch. And three of the great stretches that I love, and we do this in my group training class, and I also add it in my Serenity Bootcamp class, and it's called YTW. And you just stretch your arms over your head, and you'll feel the spine lengthen, and you take that breath in.
Uh-huh.
And you can bring your hands together out in front of your chest and pull your shoulders back, and then open your chest.
Mm-hmm.
So that's our T.
Yes.
And then we go into our W. So we come back to that second position and then open up those hands into a W position. And what it does is it spreads the chest open nice and wide. It engages the muscles in our shoulders to remind us to bring them back and down. And it elongates the muscles in your arms.
Mm-hmm.
And it moves the shoulder girdle, because when we're sitting at our desk and at our computers, we're not moving this area. The reason I suggest the ball is that because you can move your hips. Now, if you're sitting in a chair, then what you can do is pull your knee towards your chest and just stretch out your back.
Okay.
As you're sitting at your desk. And you can also lean forward on your desk and stretch your back.
Uh-huh.
Now, and we don't think without doing anything, you can stretch your back. Just put your arms on your desk. You remember when you were little and you played 7-Up?
No, I just remember taking naps in school.
So when we're little and we played 7-Up, you could put your head down, and they played that game. So it's really just putting your head down on your desk with your back stretching out and then coming back up.
Okay.
But just taking a moment to do those stretches and then getting up. And I tell people, stand for 3 minutes every hour. You may have to put a reminder on your calendar or on your phone to say, hey, get up and stand for 3 minutes, because those 3 minutes send blood back to your brain.
Sure.
Now, which is important.
What about those of us, for example, Ian and I should have been hiking along the Inca Trail to Machu Picchu in Peru this year. That's not going to happen. You know, it's a 26-mile trail. I'm certainly not physically ready to do that right now. So what are some things for people who may be looking at going on a long hike after restrictions lift, or a very long walk? What are some things that they should be doing to keep the hips a little bit flexible and the legs strong?
So the stretching every day is going to actually help you do those things. And I'll stand up. For your hips, you want to think about just pushing your hips back to stretch them out. That's all you really need to do to stretch out the glutes, get your hamstrings ready. And you're going to be walking. So what's the best thing to do? If you're studying math, you're going to repeat that same thing. You're going to practice those problems. So if you're going to be walking, it's the same thing. You're preparing the body to walk. If you're going to be increasing elevation, then you need to walk elevated. If you can't get to a place that has elevation, you use stairs. Mm-hmm. And you climb and you climb and you climb. And what you're doing is you're training your body for the activity that you actually want to do. So if you're going to be walking, walk more, walk daily. If you're going to be going up and elevation is going to be included, you're going to want to use stairs, climb. It's going to improve your VO2 max, and it's going to improve your cardiovascular endurance. You could do strength training as well, but because you're actually going to be walking and climbing when you're hiking, that's what you need to do.
One of the challenges that many people are facing during this time right now is that whether it's pursuing a fitness goal, a weight goal, perhaps training for events that are being canceled. So finding that motivation to continue to exercise, what sorts of things would you recommend for people to remain motivated about a fitness program when there may not be a goal that is out there for them to reach, even though there's always some benefit from training?
Like the marathons and the Olympic Games.
Exactly. So I know that with the Boston Marathon, I believe people can do it virtually and still qualify. So that means you can take your own personal best time, and that's your motivator. So improve it. You can say every 6 months, I want to hit and improve my best time until I'm able to run in the Boston Marathon. Because by the time you actually do, you're going to be besting yourself. You're going to be the best you can be when you show up. So tracking that time, not only that, finding groups that can motivate you online as well. When you have a shared common interest, which is what a race is, and you're competing and you're talking about your training, it keeps you engaged. We're currently doing a fitness app challenge through work. And I let people choose whatever that challenge is going to be. Some people are just choosing motivation to get up and get out and do something every day. And that's all they post is, what did I do today? What got me motivated? What kept me going? Other people are actually doing squat challenges. Some people are just drinking water. But it's a common thread. You have to have a group. I mean, we're human beings. We like to be social. Which is why this has been very difficult for us. But we have to find other ways to be connected emotionally and physically to do what we've been doing. And I go for walks and I have calls with people while I'm on my walks, because now I know when I get that text message, ooh, I'm gonna have a great conversation with someone while I'm out walking. And they're not even right next to me. But it keeps me motivated, it keeps me engaged.
So, Neila, I know you like to travel. I know there's a couple of places you really have really enjoyed. What is your most memorable travel experience to date?
My favorite. All right. So I have actually two. My most favorite was my trip to Vancouver. I loved Vancouver. And my second is when I went to Honduras. So I loved Vancouver because it doesn't really snow there and it doesn't get really cold. So I love the temperature. And I loved the fact that it was by the water. It was beautiful. But those are also things that I liked about Honduras. It was beautiful. It was by the water. But there, it's much warmer. And the people were so warm and friendly. And I got the feeling from the guide that we had, because they had never been under European rule, they were always a pirate island. They just kind of they learned to get along. They learned to live on an island by themselves as human beings on a planet and just created their own society. Everyone contributes, everyone's equal. And that was a wonderful, wonderful experience for me while I was there.
Now, as we get through this pandemic, people are starting to make plans. There's an uptick in travel bookings and things such as that airlines and other travel suppliers are beginning to see. What sorts of plans are you making once this pandemic is behind us in terms of something that you'd like to do that you haven't been able to do, or a place you want to travel to that you haven't been?
So this year we were supposed to go to Paris, and we had to delay that. So that will be our next goal. That's our plan, is to go to Paris. I did talk to my daughter, and she felt as though some people in our family who have mothers and daughters should do a mother-daughter gathering. And she said, I think once the pandemic is done and it's safe to have people get together, Mom, I think that's one of the things that we should do. So those are my plans. Those are two great things that we want to do together. And then we're going to do a family trip.
Excellent. So let's pretend the pandemic has lifted and you're on that long haul flight to Paris.
Mm-hmm.
If you could choose one person, past or present, to sit next to, who would that be?
Eartha Kitt.
Hmm.
Wow.
Love her too.
She's what?
Catwoman from the day.
Yes, exactly. Catwoman, but guess what? She was well-traveled. Mm-hmm. She was an amazing being on this planet who connected to the world in a different way. And I just find her, I've always found her very interesting.
Well, Neila, thank you so much for sharing. Thank you for keeping us, getting us going and inspiring us to stay fit.
Yes.
And I wish you well, my dear. Thank you for your stories, and be well, be safe, and to our audience, keep smiling.
Thank you.